Wow, more evidence that lawyers will say and do anything, regardless of the facts, to protect their cash cows. And, you know, there's plenty of it. All you have to do is communicate with a lawyer, and you're going to be misdirected, misinformed. And this is absolutely no exception, especially when you look at the motive. This is a billion-dollar industry. When you just look at traffic, just traffic, and that's what this is here. This is filed by a lawyer in Tennessee, Kristen L. Korn. She is claiming to be the city of Franklin, because here she's writing as the city of Franklin's response comes now the city of Franklin. She doesn't even say buying through their attorney, just comes now city of Franklin. So right there, we've already gotten documentation, evidence to show that the city of Franklin, as opposed to what they're trying to convince the defendant of, is not a geographic area. And they're going to try to base their opinion that he was within the city of Franklin based on nothing more than his physical location, which, as we see, you know, it obviously is not. Because a physical location, geographic area, cannot respectfully request. So what she's doing, she's opposing the motion that the client had gotten from me. And she's saying that there is a case, crime, or cause of action here. This defendant alleges in his motion that there is no case or cause of action because there has been no loss or damage. There was no injury. There was no violation of any legal rights and, of course, no adversary. She comes in and starts claiming something about maloprohibitum. That is, they are wrong because they are prohibited by statute. I really don't think that her only witness is going to be testifying to prove beyond a reasonable doubt the applicability of that statute. They just assume that. She goes on to say, the fact that neither injury, loss, nor damage occurred is not a defense, and any argument derived from such a notion is baseless. Well, she then goes on to further compound her problem and states that municipal courts in Tennessee have long been considered civil courts rather than criminal courts. Do you really think she's going to want to hear someone asking her in court, or me calling on the phone, or anyone asking, if this ticket or these proceedings are in the nature of a contract dispute or a tort? I doubt it. Anyway, she is claiming that, again, that it's not a defense, and any argument derived from such a notion is baseless, that there has to be an injury. So it has to be an injury. Well, I'm going to show you where we got that baseless notion from. Yes, it's from, this is the Tennessee part of the standing cross-reference on my website, markstevens.net. And we go down here and we see where this is quoted in the motion. She's saying this is a baseless notion. I didn't write it. I quoted it. It's from the Tennessee Supreme Court. I didn't write it. You know, it says, here's the baseless notion. A court may and properly should refuse to entertain an action at the instance of one whose rights have not been involved or infringed. Really, the same as the case and controversy clause in the U.S. Constitution. It has been said that no case of controversy is presented where the plaintiff lacks standing to sue. In determining whether the plaintiff has a personal stake to confer standing, the focus should be on whether the complaining party has alleged an injury in fact. Wow. And there's a couple more here. And I went and looked to see, you know, I found more on the internet here. I looked up Mayhew versus Wilder. And it's been affirmed many, 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 many times. It says a court may and properly should refuse to entertain an action at the insistence of one whose rights have not been invaded or infringed. In order for a party to show he has standing, he must demonstrate a distinct and palpable injury. Yeah, and a causal connection between the injury and the alleged conduct and a remedy available to address the injury. So, contrary to what Ms. Korn is saying here, it is not a notion that's baseless, and it is a defense. If they have not alleged an injury, regardless of what you call the statute, if there is no injury, there's no cause of action. If there is no cause of action, there's no jurisdiction, because the court is limited to only a case or controversy, justiciable case or controversy. And this is why they're even called adversarial proceedings. She says that defendant's argument that this court lacks jurisdiction is flawed. No, there has to be a valid cause of action. Defendant's continual repetition that there is no cause of action is flawed, as it is clear that a violation has occurred. No, it's not flawed, because they have not shown that anyone's rights were violated. So it is not flawed. She also disagrees, where she says that the complaint is fit for adjudication. Now, you notice she doesn't even use the word adversary throughout this entire document. Nowhere here, because this is where, you know, this is where we had quoted from the Supreme Court, and I'll show that in a second, why it was unfit for adjudication. I mean, the reason why I said it was unfit for adjudication was because I was quoting from some lawyers called the Supreme Court. It's not that I wrote it. I was just quoting it. So she very wisely, for an attorney, avoids any discussion of the word adversary, because to be an adversary, there has to be something that happens. So the Supreme Court in Poe versus Allman has laid that out. So if we go down here, you can see where I quoted from. Right. The court, meaning the Supreme Court, I thought they were the top guys, the court of last resort, the court has found unfit for adjudication any cause that is not in any real sense adversary, that does not assume the honest and actual antagonistic assertion of rights to be adjudicated. Again, it does not assume the honest and actual antagonistic assertion of rights to be adjudicated. When we go back here, she admits, the woman admits and claims that there doesn't have to be an injury. Well, without an injury, you don't have an adversary. And if there is no adversary, there's no jurisdiction. The court has found unfit for adjudication any cause that is not in any real sense adversary. So it doesn't matter if they start arguing and say, whoa, malo prohibitum. You can pass all the malo prohibitum laws that you want. The fact remains there's a legal standard in place that they can't do an end run around. The courts are limited to only a case of controversy. So if they pass a statute or a law that does not, by the violation of create a, doesn't violate and involve the violation of someone's legal rights, there is no jurisdiction. She even goes down so far as the claim. I wrote that the defendant's, she writes, the defendant's argument that the court's jurisdiction is not enlarged by police authority is without merit. So she's taken the other side. She believes that the court's jurisdiction is enlarged by police authority. I've never heard where if the police are given a grant of authority that the courts automatically have an enlargement of jurisdiction. As far as I know, the issue, the principle, the requirement that there be an adversary in an adversarial proceeding, that has not been repealed. So no amount of police authority can make an adversary proceeding into a non-adversarial proceeding into an adversarial proceeding. So she thinks just the opposite. Defendant's final argument that the court's jurisdiction is not enlarged by police authority is without merit and utterly nonsensical. Well, just for the status out there, there's supposed to be such a thing with the American system called checks and balances. So she's not looking at that. So it doesn't matter what the police have the authority, the statutory authority to do. It does not relieve them or anybody else from the requirement to have an honest and actual antagonistic assertion of rights presented to the court before jurisdiction can be acquired. So just to end this, I want to put these two together so it's a little easier to see the dishonesty here and what can you expect from a lawyer, especially one who's protecting a $1 billion cash cow. So she's insisting the fact that neither injury, loss, nor damage occurred is not a defense, and any argument derived from such a notion is baseless. Now remember, when she signed this, she certified that it was accurate and that it was consistent with current law. Well, current law says a court may and properly should refuse to entertain an action at the insistence of one whose rights have not been invaded or infringed. In order for a party to show that he has standing, he must demonstrate a distinct and palpable injury. So there you've got, so I just leave it there and to show the contradiction there.